everyone. My name is Hannah Holman. Welcome to the fifth of this series on influential female cellists. Today, I wanted to introduce you to a female cellist named Winifred Mays. I grew up in Jackson, Michigan, a small town outside of Ann Arbor. I was playing in the Jackson Symphony. And when I was 15, in my junior year, I got to sit on the front stand with this woman named Winifred Mays. And I knew that she was a big deal and an amazing cellist and super nice, but I really didn't know much else about her. Then fast forward about 30 years or so, and I'm compiling a list of influential female cellists, and I knew I wanted to have Miss Mays on my list. I couldn't really find much about her, but I did find that she was born in 1919. So then I did some digging, and I connected with her son, and he told me that she was living in a retirement community in Washington State, and I had a Skype interview with her last fall. So let me tell you about Winifred's life. She was born in Yakima, Washington, August 23rd, 1919. She started her musical journey on the piano, which she learned with her mother. She told me that she was always singing and had a good ear, and her mother thought she should maybe study something else. Her mother heard that there was a cello teacher that had just moved to Yakima named Cornelia Appy. So her mother had her start cello with Cornelia at the age of 10. Cornelia had a small class of four girl cellists. She studied with Cornelia all through high school. When she was 19, she had to decide what was next. So it was either go to the University of Washington and study home economics, or her Scottish mother had heard about the Curtis Institute and thought, well, there's some good scholarships and it's free, so maybe we should try. Winifred had never heard of Curtis, but she auditioned at Curtis and got in. Her being so humble, she thought that she was only admitted because they needed to make their presence known in the Pacific Northwest. But I know it was because she was a great cellist. She started at Curtis in the class of Felix Salmond, and when he retired, she then studied with Gregor Piatigorsky. In one of the early recitals in Salmond's class, she played the Pauper Hungarian Rhapsody. Everybody was so impressed, and she said, I have to tell you that though both Salmond and Piatigorsky were great cellists, neither of them were great teachers. And she said that she learned almost everything from her first teacher, Cornelia Appy. While she was at Curtis, she met and later married cellist Arthur Winograd. Arthur Winograd started the Juilliard Quartet and was the first cellist with Bobby Mann. The quartet was on the road a lot, and they decided to separate and later get a divorce. Winifred was a single mother in need of a job, so in 1949, she became the principal of the Fort Wayne Philharmonic. Her sister, Lois, a flute player who was in the Chicago Symphony, New York City Opera, and later in the Boston Symphony, told her about a job opening in the Boston Symphony. Winifred thought that it was crazy, and her sister convinced her to go and take the audition. Winifred secretly snuck away to Boston to take the audition. She was the only woman at the audition. It was her and 12 other male cellists. For the second round, they picked two people, her and cellist Bill Stokey, and took the screen down. And Charles Munch picked her. It was the highlight of her whole life to get that job that day. It was while she was in Boston that she met and married Samuel Mays. Samuel Mays was a great cellist, principal of Boston Symphony. Well, when Charles Munch left Boston Symphony, Eric Leinsdorf came in, and I think Leinsdorf and Samuel Mays did not quite see musically eye to eye, so Sam was going to resign. And around that time, Eugene Ormandy came to guest conduct and convinced Mr. Mays to become his new principal cellist in the Philadelphia Orchestra, and offered Winifred a job in the cellist section as well. So the two of them moved to Philadelphia and became members of the Philadelphia Orchestra in 1964. The assistant principal at that time was a female cellist, whom we might speak of later, named Elsa Hilger. She retired in 1970, and there was an internal audition for assistant principal. Winifred was one of five that took the audition, and Ormandy picked her. And again, her being so humble, she couldn't believe it that he picked her. And according to a newspaper article I read, Ormandy had his eye on her for a long time. He had heard her play the solos in the St. John Passion and was moved by how beautifully she played them. So then it became a big deal that they were first stand of the Philadelphia Orchestra, of course. There was lots of newspaper articles written on the two of them. In 1973, though, Samuel Mays got a little bit tired of playing Beethoven 5 over and over again and decided to retire. Winifred remained as assistant principal in Philadelphia until 1977. Samuel Mays took a teaching position at the University of Michigan in Ann Arbor. She was only a woman of 58 at that time, so she was looking for things to do in Michigan, which is how she ended up playing in the Jackson Symphony, amongst other things. So I feel so fortunate that I got to meet and sit with this woman who became an influence in my life. I asked her what her musical highlight of her life was, and she told me it had to definitely be getting into Boston. Thank you so much for joining me today. I hope you've enjoyed learning about Mrs. Winifred Mays. And I just want to leave you with a few takeaways. One is that if you don't try, you won't get it. She was in this junior college, auditioned for Curtis, and got in. She was in the Fort Wayne Philharmonic, auditioned for Boston Symphony, and got in. She was the first female string player in the Boston Symphony. She is an incredible, humble groundbreaker, and she, I think, doesn't even really realize all of her many contributions. But I feel so fortunate to have met her while I was in high school and reconnected with her just recently. So thank you, Winifred. Happy 100th birthday. Mwah.